conversation.
Hey, buddies.
What's up?
Welcome to track 29 of We Love Rock Operas, where tonight we'll be discussing Marianas Trench album, Ever After.
Yes.
I was like, Marianas Trench's album? Like, it just didn't sound right when the sentence was coming out of my mouth. So the album Ever After by Marianas Trench. Let's go with that.
There you go.
I am one of your hosts, Joshua Reckless, and with me as always,
Truth or Rob.
And Jeff Marianas Trench.
All right. Cool. We're talking the third album by Marianas Trench, entitled Ever After, and it starts with the title track, Ever After. I'm not myself, but I can guarantee that when I get back, you won't believe that you know me well. Don't want to think about it. I'm fucking tired of getting sick about it. Now stand back up and be a man about it. And fight for something, fight for something, fight for something.
Hey.
All right, opening track, Ever After. This album was released in 2011, and this is exactly what I love about Marianas Trench. It's this opening track where it goes musically all over the place.
You know, so good.
Brings you into many different areas, as you know they've been known to do, both on Astoria that we've covered in the opening track of that and the closing track of Phantoms. And that's why this is one of my favorite tracks on the album, because this is 100% the reason I love this band.
It's so good. Guys, 29 episodes in, I finally have notes. That's how excited I am listening to this album. This is amazing. What opener, I say. And then seriously though, I like when like songs feature other song titles in the song, like you know, double of them within the song, like you know, the Porcelain and the Toy Soldiers and stuff. And like there's this one part towards like the middle-ish slash near the end, that's the symphony part. Holy shit. The first time I was listening to this, I was doing dishes, and it just blew me. It just blew me away. I was like headbanging and shit. I was getting into it. It was so good. So good. And then after it was over, I was so hyped to listen to the rest of the album, you know. And I appreciate the fact that there's no skips, no pauses. It's all one long, smooth transition between each song. There's no like skipping or pauses or anything in between. It's just one track to another.
Yep.
So, but this is the way to kick off an album and the story, which is another funny story because, you know, I try to interpret the story as to what it was about. When I actually read what it was about, I'm like, I was way off. But, you know, oh man, it's wild. It's a ride, that's for sure. So,
yeah, it's definitely a strong opener. Gets you excited, gets the energy set for a good part, especially the next song. So. Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, this song is kind of like a prologue to your story. Like, it's not necessarily the beginning of your story. It's more, it's the chapter before chapter one kind of thing if you're reading a book.
Yeah.
Is how I saw it.
Yeah.
I have to point out, Rob, that we are also an audio podcast, so thumbs up do not help people that might be listening.
But people watching on our YouTube channel, Heyyy Buddy, will benefit from it. That's for you guys.
Great. Great thumbs up. Anyway, that leads us into what I believe is the start of our actual story. Track 2, Haven't Had Enough. The song just gets me dancing.
Yeah, it's definitely more poppy than the first one.
Yeah.
But also, like, so we didn't really, I mean, the premise here, basically, to me, anyways, this is what I was, you know, is this basically is about the main character, you know, and is, you know, obviously is now Ed's girlfriend. You know, he's having, you know, troubles with his ex, or he's going through it with his, you know, girlfriend, or not girlfriend anymore. But with this song, it's like, well, are they still saying or not? Because of what he's, if you listen to the lyrics, you know, with what he's saying, it's like, well, are they done or not? You know, right. Or what's, so that's what I got out of this. But then by the third song, you can definitely.
Well, we're not there.
I know. I'm sorry. I got ahead of myself. I'm excited.
Our protagonist is very much convinced that, you know, the other participant in this relationship hasn't had enough.
Right.
I do like the sandwiching of the beginning of testing. I'm just suggesting you and I might not be the best thing. And then you go through the entire song and it ends with, I'm just suggesting you and I might just be the best thing.
That's, yeah, I meant to write that. I forgot. That's, yeah, that's another thing I was going to mention too.
It's questioning everything where things aren't going right now.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, maybe we just started everything, like maybe we need to stop and reset, maybe we started everything wrong, like this could be the greatest relationship, but we fucked it up to here. And if we started all differently, maybe it would be completely different.
You know, it's like playing Skyrim and you get past the first level and then you're like, what if I did this as a Nord instead? And then you get there again, and you're like, what if I did this? Not as a Nord.
You're losing the
whole idea what you're talking about.
Josh hates Skyrim.
Past level one? What the hell is that?
Let's see. It's
past creating a character?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like Carlito joining the LWO and then leaving again. And then going back and leaving. That's where it is.
All right. On that note, it brings us to track 3, By Now. This song sneaks up on you. This song gets stuck in my head like crazy. And it was never one of my go-to songs when I first listened to this album. But man, does it just get stuck in my brain.
Yeah, lyrically, it's so good. So good. And that chorus, I can't, you know, it's That's the part that it stuck in your head. Is that better than better, you know?
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah, so it's such a heartbreaking thing because I was also thinking back to Astoria when we covered it. You got this song being, you know, sometimes the one you want is not the one you need. Mm-hmm. And then you listen to One Love in Astoria where it's like, well, sometimes the only love is the one that you get. So one hand, you got this guy being like, look, maybe we're not perfect for each other. Maybe we're not supposed to be together. And then in the other album, you got, well, what if that was my chance? And I fucked it up because I didn't see it. So I think those two pair really well together. This one is my second favorite on the album.
Nice.
Yeah.
This one makes me think of a relationship I was with in my early 20s that Steve knows well. Her name was Natalie. And I worked overnights and I literally woke up one day and to her packing all of her stuff and moving out of our apartment. So the whole, can we just pretend to sleep? Like part of me just wanted to do that, knowing what was going on. And she was very much like, sometimes not the one you want is what is it? Is not the one you need.
The one you want. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was what she very much wanted to marry me, but she was in her early 20s and wasn't ready for that at the time. And it was like, hey, when I'm ready to get married, I'll come back to you. And it's just like, that's not how things work.
No.
She's like, but I want to, you know, do other stuff right now. So this reminds me of her big time.
At what point in the other relationship would she go, oh, just so you know, though, when I'm ready for us to get serious, I got another guy that I'm going to...
Yeah. When I'm ready for marriage, I'm out.
Yeah,
it makes no sense. Shout
out to Natalie. How you doing?
Yep.
Just you wait. We got another song coming up later in the album. Got to open up a can of worms on that one.
All right.
But as it pertains to the story with the song, yeah, obviously you can tell it definitely not. And on the same page, and like he assumed that she had the same feelings, but she doesn't. So, yep.
Josh Ramsey, he can write about love and heartbreak and heartache like the best of them. And
I mean,
that's why they're amazing.
Like the lyrics is just incredible. And
yes.
The way he sings it, just. It's where the hell has this band been all my life? I don't know. Seriously, I'm not blowing smoke up anyone's ass. I legit love this band. This is like become one of my new favorites now. I'm not even kidding. So thank you guys.
Awesome. Well, Jeff, if you grew up in Canada, you would have to go to literally a stadium to see this band.
Oh man,
they're huge.
But you know what else I was thinking? I know we're like two tracks past it already, but that opening track, I feel like this whole thing should be like a Broadway show, you know, like a music or something.
That I know, like I was just thinking about how Metallica, you know, went on tour with the full orchestra before.
Oh, S&M, yes.
How much I would love to see that from Marianas Trench. We'd probably have to go to Canada to get that performance, but I would 100% travel over there for something like that. I think
they never tour in the States.
They do, but they don't have a record label in the States. So
that's wild.
They just play
what
small.
The hell are we doing?
They play small clubs in the States, and then they literally play football stadiums in Canada.
Oh, wow.
So completely different. If you're going to bring the orchestra out, it's probably for the stadiums, not the small clubs. So that brings us to the next track, Truth or Dare.
Easy as 1, 2, 3, do you see what I do? Truth or dare, you set up for there, you do you me. Now I think you got it. One last breath and just been
you don't need to be so worried. Even though below, I'm still thinking about it. One, two, three, let's go. We'll be in the
truth, dare.
Okay, this is my favorite song on the album.
Is it?
Yes. And I can't remember the Astoria song that I brought the same comparison to, where it's not exactly what Mike did, but it's all right for a white kid. Which song was that?
Hey. Yes.
Yeah, my one that note, one in Astoria.
My one note this, for this. Size. I, yeah. Real quick, my one note for this is, could picture MJ singing this. This is we're on the same track.
Yeah, this is definitely like you get the sense of Michael Jackson probably during the Bad or the Dangerous tour. It's got that feel to it that just, it's pop, but it's this like undertone of like angst, just a little bit. And just like a little bit of danger to it, no pun intended. Well, kind of intended, but yeah, no, I love the song.
Yeah,
awesome. Yeah, the whole song is basically him daring, you know, this other party to take a chance, take a risk, risk it all. Don't be a bitch.
Don't be a bitch.
And once again, you get your tonal change on the album, and you know that's what makes them awesome, is your fluctuation between songs. And but it's from, like you said, Jeff, from one song right into the other song, so it's completely different, but they find a way to blend it beautifully.
Oh yeah,
yeah, and it's him saying,
"Let's take a risk." Yeah. There's also like a familiar melody throughout the whole album when they do the transitions, and it's from the first track, you know, on basically. It's that like chorus of Oz, you know, when they you know what I'm talking about. But it's pretty, I like that.
Cool. Brings us to some desperate measures.
For a first effort, this feels kind of last ditch. I guess this just got kind of drastic. Trust us, you just fell off the bus, baby.
By this point, I'm starting to think, okay, you know, now we're getting a little carried away here, you know, a little upset much, you know, like maybe you should let it go, okay? Because it's like, I don't know, man. Just if she's not that into you, she ain't that into you, pal. I don't know, you know, don't go to the extreme of changing yourself or whatever. For, you know, I wouldn't do that for any girl, but you know, whatever. Yeah, that's just me.
Yeah. It's that double-edged sword of like, you hope you don't change for nobody, you know, that you hold that to yourself, but then there's that one girl where you're like, well, I could change some things. You're just hoping that it's worth it. There's one lyric in this one that I wanted to point out, and I don't have it in front of me because Spotify's being dumb.
Yeah, so I mean, this is his desperation. It is him going to lengths that, you know, he's ready to go to lengths that are, you know, a little over, above and beyond, like you said, Jeff. But he's ready to do it.
Yeah. Oh, God. The lyric, have a piece of American dream. Open up and swallow on your knees. I was eating, listening to that, and I almost choked.
Like, and say thank you.
And say thank you.
It'd be more prophetic if you were sucking a wiener and you heard that line.
I was enjoying some nachos. Thank you very
much for the input,
Mr. Producer.
They don't call me Super Producer for nothing.
On that note, let's get into the beautiful porcelain. Much different than Desperate Measure. Slows it down.
Yeah.
What did you guys think of Porcelain?
It's a beautiful song.
Yeah, I love the alliteration of the, you know, Perfect Porcelain. I love that. And then I have the way the song is structured. I wrote here, you know, Coldplay fits you, question mark. Because it kind of reminds me of that song, how it starts off low. And wait. And then just the way that the musically, I mean, then it goes, you know, the harder a little bit at the end. And it's like, you know, I dug it.
Right.
Yeah, I'm assuming Coldplay is not one of your favorites. Moving on.
Fix Me is a good song. I like that song. I can say when I like a song. Overall, no, you'd be correct. But Fix Me is a good song. It's very much, I mean, porcelain. You think of porcelain dolls. You know, they're very delicate, valuable. So he's kind of holding her up on this, to this, this high value. And he's talking to her about, hey, you know, we thought we'd have, you know, everything figured out by now. Life would be figured out. But as seasons change, so do people. And so I'm holding you up in this high regard. We have not figured things out. Things have not gone, you know, perfectly in the direction we wanted.
Yeah, and I mean it's a good going back to the second track, you know, the line of it's easy to see it's for the best when you want more while you leave me with less. It's never been enough, like just me has not been enough for you. And it's okay if you are still trying to figure out why or if I can be enough, but yeah. But relationships are hard, guys. They're hard.
That's what it is. Okay. So let's get into a song we've heard a few times on this show before, but not by Josh Ramsey. Fallout. So for 25-ish episodes, this was our opening and closing song done by the producer and I, and we finally do the album it's from, and we decide not to open and close.
Yeah, what the hell? What the
hell? I was waiting for that.
With the song.
Damn, I just realized.
Half-assed attempt with a 20-minute practice of covering this song doesn't stand up to Josh Ramsey, and I'm not going to play it in the same episode in which we can be compared.
Okay.
Recorded on a cell phone.
Point of order, you could have just taken the part of Ramsey saying, I know you're fine, but what do I do? And just slide it.
Yo, you guys made it acoustic.
That's right. Tell them, Jeff.
Made it your own.
So, you guys obviously know kind of what this means to myself and Super Producer, since it's one of the only songs we've actually recorded ourselves doing in the last 10 years, 15 years. What do you guys think of Fallout?
I might have to redact myself. This might be my favorite. just that, you know, I'm like on my last leg here, and you seem to be doing just perfect over there.
Perfectly fine. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's got someone new, apparently.
So. Yeah, I'm on the ledge while you're so goddamn polite and composed. It's like, yeah.
Yeah, it's like he's on the edge of losing it. He's breaking down. He's ready to jump because he's so lost. He's so hopeless at this point. And then he runs into her, sees her or whatever, and she seems perfectly fine. And he's just like, why the fuck are you not as torn up about all this as I am? And this is bullshit.
Yeah. It's like he spent the whole journey of, okay, she just needs to find herself, but she'll be, you know, we're meant to. This is Boy Meets World, the album. Just a little bit.
How is that?
This is the, it's okay. We're supposed to be together. You know, the universe says we're supposed to be together. She just hasn't figured that out yet. And then immediately sees her with someone else and goes, wait, no, what the hell? That's not how this is supposed to work. This is, no, she comes back to me and we live happily ever after. Not, you know, it's that line. I'm supposed to see other people. You're supposed to wait till I die.
That's yes. Yes. Exactly. And you know, some people, myself included, have been there where, you know, you've had a breakup and one person takes it a hell of a lot better than the other one because somebody thought that, you know, it was going better than the other person, obviously. Who had been planning their escape or, you know, whatever else. And, you know, there's winners and losers in breakups. And he's the loser in this breakup.
Yep. Yeah, so, you're so busy trying to play chess and then she says checkmate and you're like, wait, what the hell happened?
What? Yeah, I see what you did there.
And you start to stutter. Now, here's a song when I first heard it, I thought it was so stupid. Just because he's stuttering through the song. But man, have I grown to love this. And I think it's so much fun to sing.
Such a fun song. This is the one after the first run through of this album that got stuck in my head. And I, you know, seeing it at work the next day over that line. And it's just wow. also, surprisingly, if you look on Marianas' Spotify page, this is the number one most played song.
Oh, really?
Yeah, with like 41,000 plays or something like that. It's wild.
Yeah.
So. But yeah, started.
This is him still sinking. Like he's begging her to basically give him a reason to live again, like bring me back to life. Like I am a corpse of what I used to be. And he thinks he needs her to become, you know, a part or a piece of what he used to be, or even just a living human being.
It's the classic, I don't know who I am without you.
Yes.
And I've spent the days being like, she'll come back. She'll come back. She's not coming back. No, no, you're not supposed to come back here.
The, oh shit. I had it. What the hell? Hold on. It's coming to me. I lost it. Damn it.
Well, there it goes.
Yep.
And it's gone. It's gone.
It's all right. We can leave it. We can leave it right where it laid. And we can talk about some toy soldiers.
I will love you like goodbye. I will love you like you died. Died a martyr for me. Don't you want love? Don't you want this? Don't you look so shocked? It's not the way I planned it. I deserve a little more. What did you say? Oh, ayo, ayo. Don't you want love? Don't you fight back? No, this will hurt less if you just submit. So how about a little gratitude for what I say? Oh, ayo, ayo.
Okay, before we get into the song, I just remembered what I was going to say about the last one. So one of the things I like also about this band is that they, you know, while the song itself is like up and tough, you know, and happy and all that, it's the message. It's not really a happy message or a happy song. It's not supposed to be a happy song, but they make it happy, and it's wild to me. Yeah. That's what I meant about stutter. So, yeah.
It's kind of, oh, what's the word I'm looking for? Yeah, this is his stalker song. This is his stalker era. This is, I'll love you like you died for me. It's like, don't you want this relationship? I don't understand. Why are you running? What's wrong with me? For the audio listeners, just picture wide-eyed and crazy.
Yeah. It sounded like... for the toy soldiers, you mean? Yeah, it sounded like he was like threatening at one point. I'm like, what are we doing?
Yeah. Yeah. And then the tail end of that song where he's like, understand, it's like he's fading out. Like the energy doesn't change, but it's like, understand you just like I do. You know, they don't know you like I do.
Right.
Where he's like, I'm going to love you like you died for me.
Yeah. Like, hey. Hey, stupid, don't you want to be loved? You dummy.
Yeah, and I was, and I mentioned how
pushing this away.
I mentioned how it was almost like he's threatening her. So
that's exactly what I got out of it.
Yeah. What are we doing?
That leads to one of my favorite songs on the album.
Oh, here we go.
B Team.
You get right up and I'm the one done. You never say yes, not quite no. Say just enough to make me not go. You choose your words, careful voice. In the end, I'm not the first choice. You say you want someone just like me. So then why am I your plan? Why am I your plan? Why am I your plan B? You know, you know, you love the way I linger and you keep me wrapped around your finger. But you say, just wait a minute.
Yeah.
So, super producer here, I have to jump on first just to say that this song is literally about my life, which is why I love it so much. There was a girl that I was the B team for a very long time, and turned out she was still looking for me, because now I'm married with a kid and she's still single trying to find another person that's like me. Sucks when you do that. All right, enjoy.
I was going to say, sure. Show of hands. Who's been there before? I was in that, you know, shit. Yep. I mean, granted, now we're all better off because we got all, you know, we're all married. But back in the day, man, oh my God, I don't understand. I'll never understand. It's either you're in, you know, it's like you're what they're looking for in a guy, but they don't want you. Like, what? How does that make sense? That doesn't make any sense. I don't know. I mean, I've had this happen to me on more than one occasion, mind you. You know, it's just mind-boggling. But
it's always they don't want you at this moment, like my story earlier.
Right, like, yeah. I don't,
Just wait a little longer.
Yeah, but then it's too late. You know, you had your chance and you fucked it up.
I will say, though, that I've seen Facebook posts of me when this was me before I met my wife. I don't like the person that I was.
Jesus.
I was a definite, like, nice guy syndrome is a thing.
Yeah.
And I recommend quitting it as soon as possible if you're listening to it and you think, but I'm such a nice guy.
He's giving all the men out there permission to be misogynistic assholes. Just letting you know.
No.
That's from Rob.
That's the exact Rob. Opposite of what I'm saying.
The views, opinions expressed by Rob and Rob alone.
Well, I got a lot of
every opinions. New episode Let's... we have is going to have a warning in the video. That says these views do not reflect our views. They are only the view of Rob Buck.
All I'm saying is that the more you try to say, like, I don't understand, I'm right here, you know, sometimes it's not okay to just be like, I don't understand why you don't just, you know, go out with me, you know. You say you're looking for someone just like me. Well, I'm right here. Well, sometimes you're not the dude, like, and I'm speaking as all the, like, I'm speaking to the ether, to past Rob, and be like, you're a dipshit, and like,
it's not Rob saying being, you know, misogynistic asshole. I get what you're saying, Rob, and I fully agree. The moment I stopped caring about being Mr. Nice Guy about everything I did, and not so much like being an asshole, but quit just focusing on tending to their every need and like overdoing it. Yep. You think you're being a nice guy, but you're overdoing it, smothering, and it's annoying to them.
Hence the Butch Walker, you know, I never knew the difference between bullshit and sincere.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but the moment I started caring less is the moment everything became easier for me.
Yeah. Legit, the day I said, I'm just going to like chill out and not worry about that too much is the day my wife texted me, and the rest is history.
That's how it goes. When you stop looking, it finds you.
I will say that I was at a point where I was complete. I'm like, I'm comfortable with being single right now. Met the woman that became my wife. I was like, oh, all right.
You know, when you when you got a boomerang going your way, if you stop moving, eventually it's gonna hit. But if you keep moving, there's nowhere for the boomerang to hit.
Yep. Yeah, same with me. You know, I was perfectly fine bouncing around, having fun, and then walked into an office and there was the woman I married. You know? So, and I was like, all right, I'm going to stop bouncing around and having fun because
stop it. Cool.
It's the bouncing around part.
I'm just messing with you.
The only place he bounces now is in my bed.
But that's been pre-approved by all parties.
It was that's in both our wedding vows.
It was in our wedding vows. So yeah, absolutely love this song, B-Team. And it's great. It wasn't one of the singles on this. It's just, you know, listening through the album, I think it is something that a lot of people can definitely relate to. And this, I mean, this man can write lyrics that just pierce your heart in so many different ways, good and bad. So B-Team just strikes a chord for so many people. I'm surprised it wasn't a single, actually. I think, you know, it's also just a very catchy tune that, you know, hits you. And we're coming to the end of this album. We're getting close.
Speaking of hitting you.
So soon.
Yeah.
No, sometimes I only twist it, and maybe I'm too proud to say I missed it. But if here and now I tell you that I'm all figured out, or maybe I just like how that sounds. I know we said it's just as well that I won't keep you.
Oh man,
that was.
He cut it off too soon.
The one part to play. So
every time. Stupid YouTube.
To the good part. Yeah.
My wife's not a fan of how fast I cut it off either.
Oh, man. So, yeah. So, I gotta say, I know basically now it's. I think, you know, he's finally accepting the fact that she's with someone else, and like, you know, but he wishes that, you know, he was lonely because he wanted to be the only one for her. I mean, this song is like, it's such a beautiful yet heartbreaking song, but probably one of my favorites on the album, to be honest with you, just how, but I will say also, for the most part, throughout my life anyways, in regards to me, like, all my exes, unlike him, I, you know, wants her to be lonely. I, for the most part, not all of them, some of them could go to hell. One of them actually is in there. That's a different story.
That's the story I want.
But
we have time, Jeff. We have
all right, fine. So my ex,
all the time in the world.
I mean, not like anyone. My ex before I met my wife died of a heart attack, but more, you know, she broke up with me via text. So she's a fucking bitch. And there's a two-part YouTube. Yeah, you got me going now. There's a two-part YouTube that's still on YouTube of her, you know, telling me off and shit. But whatever, it's all stupid. Nevertheless, for the most part,
we've got to find that.
I'll send you the link. What I'm trying to get at is, I want them to be happy, or like the people that put me on the B team. There was like a couple of them that I was really good friends with, and we were in the friend zone, but I wanted them to be happy regardless, you know, because. I mean, everyone deserves some sort of happiness, you know what I mean? So, yeah, almost everyone. But, yeah, so I can't agree with his sentiment of, you know, wanting to wish that she was lonely, which I get what he was saying. But at the same time, it's like, you know, there's a good song on Blue October. Well, called I Hope You're Happy. I love that album. And that's another, it's one of my, no, I might put that as one of my songs. So So that's what makes me think about.
Yeah. So this is the song of him running into her with a new somebody on her arm. And, you know, comes to terms with, hey, I know you're going to need somebody, you know, to get through life with, but, you know, this feels so soon. Like, he's not at that same spot as her. She's moved on faster. And I get that. Like, I'm not like you. I think I wish all my exes nothing but misery, because I see him with someone else, and I'm like, well, what does this stupid cunt have that I don't? And the answer is nothing. The problem was with them. Every time. No need to look inward.
Yeah. It goes back to the thing I said about this being Boy Meets World, the album. You know, this is legit. Like, I'm supposed to see other people and be okay. You're supposed to wait till I die. This isn't how this is supposed to work.
That's right. You know,
I'm healing. The wound is healing, but like, it's still fresh. And right now it's just being ripped open again.
That's right.
And all you can do is keep telling yourself, this is, you know, can't change it. Can't change your mind for her. So you will get better. It will be better. Eventually.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he even says in the song, I will smile and I'll shake his hand, but understand, like, this isn't a cut dry split feeling.
I'm not really accepting this. Don't be fooled.
Yeah. It's like, well, hi, nice to meet you, you piece of shit.
Exactly.
My God, that brought up another memory. Never mind. I don't even want to go there. No, we're not going there. Never mind. Let's continue.
All right, Jeff's holding on to something.
So many suppressed feelings in this episode.
All right. Perfect. Well, there's no place like home.
There we go.
Right.
Damn YouTube.
All right, we got the closing track here. What'd you think, Dorothy?
I don't think we're in Kansas anymore. I like the Wizard of Oz references, obviously, and just like we started the album, this was a fantastic ending to the album. And like I mentioned in the first song, like in the first song, the callbacks they did, our previous songs were featured in this. And I always, you know, I like that a lot. And my favorite part had to be towards the end when, oh man, but just before, I can't remember what, it was after There's No Place Like Home part. Oh, the assembly line part, we were singing about that, and then you did into another, the Toy Soldier line, and then it's like one verse on top, it's like one verse on top of the other. Trans-Siberian Orchestra, there's a bunch of that stuff like that, but they do more verses, and it's, they put them together, and it comes up beautifully, and it's I love that shit. So but
the layered lyrics, layered lines,
something like that. I can't remember what it's gorgeous. The proper term for it, but
this is true love ever after. And I mean, the whole album is just kind of like a gradual nosedive. You don't get your happy ending. You get acceptance, I guess. In the end, which is also a conclusion to a story. You know, it's not one that you usually.
Seven stages of grief. I don't know, maybe not. You know, denial to acceptance.
Oh, no. Yeah. It just seems like his descent into madness and then comes up a little bit out of madness, but he doesn't really get back, you know, fully. It's kind of the start of his, you know, acceptance and conclusion at the end. And you're hoping that from here on out, it's going to keep going upwards for him. But it could. It's not very, you know, he's still not that far from the bottom at the end. Yeah. So it could easily take a turn for the worse for our poor protagonist at the end of this.
Yeah.
Because it's not so much I'm moving past my feelings for this person. Like the image of a shallow grave for like the person and all the feelings of this relationship of a shallow grave where I can keep it safe or hide away for just in case I need it.
Like, yeah,
I'm not fully going to walk away from this, but I'm going to start working on myself very slowly, but surely, but there'll always be that, you know, that chance that hand pops out of the grave and grabs my ankle.
For me, lyrically, I mean, this is a heavy, it's heartbreaking, it's everything, but musically I love dancing to this album, so this is my sweet spot, you know, upbeat songs with horrible lyrics, if you really sit down and listen to them. And a lot of times you would, like, you could sing along and not even realize what you're singing because you're just so into the beat and the tone and everything that you're just singing, and then when you really sit down and listen to it, you're like, oh my god. He is going through some shit right now.
Yeah, shit. I forgot to mention that last song.
Yeah.
Just because he's not here. I mean, he's here, but he's not with, you know, he hasn't been recorded with him a few weeks. That was my, you know, turn off all the blinds, shut off all the lights.
Light some candles. All right.
Well, there you go.
That's for you, Jay.
Yeah. Yeah.
We just call it a song.
Beautiful.
Gone full Nova.
Yes.
Full Nova. Perfect. Cool. So in my eyes, this is definitely a rock opera. And if you look at the whole thing, it seems almost like the middle, but like the front half of the middle. So maybe even like the second piece of four to a huge rock opera, you know, because it's such a small portion of, it's just, I mean, this could take place over the course of a couple weeks, really. Depending on how quick, you know, this chick has, you know, turned things around and jumped back on the horse. It could be a couple months, could be a couple weeks, but it just seems like it's such a short portion of time for like a story. So it almost seems like part two of a four-piece story. But at the end of the day, it does have his tone changes from the start of the album to the end of the album. And there is definitely, you know, a semi conclusion to what he's, you know, feeling and trying to move on from this relationship that he was so hung up on, knowing that it wasn't good for him, you know, at the beginning of the album. So I think it's a rock opera. What do you guys think?
So real quick, because I know the other previous two albums you guys covered on here, do they all is this like a big trilogy story or no, not so much? Like, are they all evolved on the same thing, same person?
He just,
not the same person.
A lot of it is influenced by somebody close to Josh's life. Yes,
that's what I meant. Not necessarily the same character in each one. But I'm saying,
but
like
the stories of each album, I don't believe are interconnected.
I see what you were saying, but I think it's basically Well, if I don't mind what it said online, it's a concept album. But I mean, to me, it does sound like a rock opera. With, you know, you had like the symphony, you had like the prologue, the middle, you know, the start, the middle, the end, you know, the ending. He even says the end in the end. So I mean, it's like it's you know, it's definitely a story, albeit, you know. Like I said, when I read it, was like a fictionalized, it's a fairy tale concept, basically. Because it's a fictionalized version of Josh in his adventures in a fantasy kingdom of Toyland. Like, what? That's what I saw when I read that. It blew my mind.
Yeah, it could be in his head. But I think it's some one person's internal struggle after a breakup. Like, he keeps talking to somebody like she's there, but she's not. Except for so soon he actually runs into her. But the rest of it, like, he addresses her like she's there, but she's not there. So I think it's like one person's internal struggle after it's man versus himself, basically.
Yeah. I will definitely go rock opera. Just narratively, there is a strong narrative through each song where, you know, we're not naming any characters or anything, but we are seeing the decline of a relationship. Told pretty straightforward. So, yeah, I would definitely go rock opera.
Cool. Let's all just do thumbs up and stay silent for 30 seconds. Yeah. All right. So some of our third go around with Marianas Trench on here. Is this your first Marianas that you've participated in, Jeff?
Yes. I've listened to the previous two, like I said.
So, overall, what'd you guys think of this album?
Loved it. Absolutely
love that. Astoria will probably still be my favorite just because it was my first. And even though Affleck was the bomb in Phantoms, you know, that was pretty good. But I'd say Ever After is, I had to work it in there. Y'all cut it, the first joke I made. I would go Ever After, or Astoria, Ever After, then Phantoms as far as what we've covered.
Nice. I love them all. This band has quickly. The first three albums were out when I discovered them. I think I discovered them shortly after this one was released. So, ever since discovering them around, I'd say 2013, it was before Astoria came out because I was at the store the day that dropped to get it. They've quickly become one of my favorite bands of all time. So I absolutely love this album, and I can't wait to cover the album that came before this, because why not? We've done all the rest. It won't be next episode.
Yeah.
Next episode is going to be We Love Rock Operas. Taste our playlist. That's what it's going to be called. Taste our playlist. And it's going to be a couple songs from each of us that we have preferably not covered on this show already that have just meant something to us. So it's almost like, you know, the songs that made Josh, Rob, and Jeffy, but combined, and a super producer, where we each had our individual ones before, and now we're just combining them into our own mixtape that will also be on Spotify, and people will be able to look up our mixtape and you know, listen to it if they want. So that'll be next episode. But we will be covering the other Marianas Trench coming up soon, because I love them. I push them on people, and I thank goodness you have enjoyed them too. So... Well, I'm not. All right. I'll let you guys say your shit. I am Joshua Reckless. Find us at Heyyy Buddy Pod on all the social medias, or Patreon/Heyyy Buddy or HeyyyBuddy.com. We'll take you to all of our shit. And signing off with me, we have Rob.
Yes, you can find me here on the Heyyy Buddy Network with the Power Chamber, which just dropped our latest episode where we meet our Stone Canyon trio of Rocky, Adam, and Aisha, and start to say goodbye to our original red, black, and yellow Rangers. So look for that. Look for the video version on Patreon. And yeah, that's all I got. Plug
it, Jeff.
You got Told You With Jeffy on Facebook and Patreon, and watch my vlogs on Jam Productions Incorporated YouTube channel.
Cool.
Oh my God. And as it pertains to Heyyy Buddy, three of us also host another podcast called Wrestling Buddies. We're two episodes in already, going to be three very soon, and I've been enjoying that one too. So,
absolutely. If you're into professional wrestling, check us out. You'll find it on our normal feed on our normal feed, Spotify or YouTube. So
I got one more plug.
We have to figure out the Apple situation.
I'm working on it.
Okay.
One more thing to plug. I'm sorry because it's just happened. Scyther Media does audio dramas across Spotify. They do X-Men, the audio drama, Power Rangers, the audio drama. They have a fantasy wrestling league where they use voice actors for their shows to cut their promos. And my episode just dropped where I am the voice of Dustin Rhodes. I also do commentary on a separate show for their as Dusty Rhodes. So
send me the link to that. Jesus. I know I listen to this. All right.
Check all that out. Until next time, thanks for having a conversation.
Conversation.